I've had a very extraordinary life, which I didn't quite appreciate till about 10 years ago. I started going to the jungles, particularly Nagarhole, when I was about a year old. Saw tigers, elephants, leopards, very close hand, thanks to my father, Dr. Vilas Karanth. And I actually happened to see my grandfather, with my first tiger with my grandfather, Dr. Shivram Karanth. What I didn't realize was how unique and extraordinary India is. And we tend to celebrate this country for so many things. We tend to celebrate it for its languages, for its history, for its culture, and now for engineering, for technology, for innovation, and for basically going to be a global superpower. For me, India is unique because of the wildlife that we have in this country. And I think to understand why we are special, we need to go back a little bit in time. So I'm going to take you back about 150 years when what I call the collapse of Indian wildlife began. And why did this collapse occur? Can we make it a little bit darker?
Yes. Switch on.
Because there's a lot of photographs. So.
Yes.
So in starting in the 1850s, the British went on these massive sport hunting operations with Indian Maharajas. So you can see the size of the operation to get one tiger, right? And so this escalated. It started in the 1850s, went on till the 1920s. It wasn't just restricted to men. There were women hunting as well. There were individuals like this man who I don't want to name, who in his lifetime shot 300 tigers, right? And I think the prize for the highest bag ever shot was this Maharaja from Bikaner. If you go to the Bikaner Palace today, there's a glass case with his hunting journal, and he alone shot almost 100,000 birds and animals. And all of this mass hunting has had huge impacts on wildlife, and that's what I was kind of interested in looking at as part of my PhD several years ago. So people went on elephant back to shoot tigers. They went by boat. This is from the Sundarbans. And of course, they started to go by car. This was the 1920s, and the advent of the car in India really accelerated the hunting that took place. And so one historian estimates that in a 50-year period, India, they shot about 80,000 tigers. And to put that in perspective, we're kind of trying to fight to save the 3,000 to 4,000 we have left today, right? They shot, the estimate is that about 150,000 leopards were shot. Again, we have maybe 10 to 15,000 leopards left in India today. And so this kind of massive rampant hunting that took place obviously causes extinctions of species. We used to be the only country in the world that had the lion, the tiger, the leopard, the snow leopard, and the cheetah. In 1960, we lost the cheetah, and the cheetah actually ranged from Africa all the way down to Mysore, and rampant hunting led to the decline of the species. So what I was interested in is the one good thing the British did was actually keep very meticulous records of what animals they'd seen and what they'd shot. So I was able to visit a lot of museums, look at gazetteer records and land tenure records, and reconstructed where people had seen or shot animals, and was able to build a database of 30,000 records and started to look at where these animals were today. So for tigers, for example, the dark blue areas show you where they are present today, and the lighter areas where they were historically but are no longer found. So tigers are gone from 67% of India. Leopards are gone from 36% of India. Wild dogs, I don't know how many people here have actually seen them, an extraordinary dog species, are gone from 62% of India. Elephants gone from 43% of India. Gaur gone from 60% of India. Cheetal, which people kind of see as a very common animal when you go to most parks, gone from 45% of India. And the only animal that seems to be doing well is the wild pig. And this is not the India that I want to see going forward, that we're left with just this one species, right? And but what's happened post this collapse? So hunting began to decline in the 1930s, 40s. But the real transformation came when Mrs. Gandhi was in power in the 1970s. She was and is the only Indian Prime Minister who's made wildlife a priority. So she set into place a lot of laws, and the national park system, launch Project Tiger, launch Project Elephant, and she's really groundbreaking in what she did for India's wildlife. So post the 1970s, we've actually seen a recovery of animals back in India. And what does that mean? We don't have animals just found in parks. They're found, I mean, if you go around Banerghatta, you will come across leopards even today, right? So you have pictures like this, which are very common. You see leopards and sloth bears and wild dogs outside. And this is of critical importance because you start to see conflict with people. So in this case, you see crop damage in a field, and in retaliation, pigs being hurt, elephants being electrocuted, you see people having their animals injured or their livestock killed by big cats or wolves. In retaliation, you see leopards beaten, leopards dragged through the streets, tigers snared, tigers poisoned. If you pick up any Indian newspaper today, there's typically one or two of these stories coming from somewhere across India, right? So we've actually succeeded in bringing the wildlife back, but the enormous sort of pushing of animals and into where people live leads to these conflicts. So over the last almost decade now, we've done work across India, and the fundamental things we were interested in understanding was what are the kinds of conflict you see. We started in Madhya Pradesh, we've worked in Rajasthan and worked in different parts of India. We've done this using volunteers because as a small team of research scientists, we're not able to gather the kind of information we need. And so 300 volunteers have come with us and walked in all of these villages trying to assess the kind of conflict we have. And this is to understand what are the species responsible, is there compensation, is there mitigation. And what it's done is we've done statistical modeling and mapping to identify, these are five Karnataka parks where you're able to identify high and low conflict areas in terms of what are the big problems. We know that crop loss is 64% of the problem, livestock is 15%. In Karnataka, we know pigs and elephants cause most of the damage. So we started to do this across India, different stories emerge. And then thanks to the, when we started to do the field work, I realized there is no all India picture of what's happening with conflict. And so we filed RTIs, this was a paper recently published, to understand what is the all India picture, and it's pretty grim. We have about almost a lakh plus incidents reported to the government across India. The Indian government reimburses people to up to about 51 crores per year. But our estimates suggest that less than 30% of people are actually reporting conflict to the government. So the number of conflict incidents we see in India is actually much higher. Of course, Karnataka is leading both in the number of incidents and the number of payouts that we do. So, but I take this as a good sign because it's also an indicator that there's still a lot of wildlife left in our state and there's more we can do to kind of balance this, right? So when you look at crop and property damage, it's very much Karnataka and Maharashtra. You look at livestock predation, it's a slightly different story. You have Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh also reporting high livestock predation. And then human injury and death. It's extraordinary that in a country of 1.4 billion people that we're just, you know, we have just 25,000 incidents reported over a 5-year period. Given the context that, you know, 500,000 people live within, 10 kilometers of each of these parks, then the numbers of human deaths and injuries are extraordinarily low, and I hope we can continue to keep it that way. So if you look at the all India picture, you have, 73% of losses are people losing their crops, which is a much easier problem to solve than the 6%, which is human injury and death. So when we started to look at this, I realized that doing all of the science actually is not making any impact on the ground. And how do we place relative to the world? We spend about $5.5 million on conflict. To put that in perspective, Sweden alone spends $90 million a year in compensating people. So about 3 years ago, coming out from this frustration that we're doing a lot of good science and it's publishing a lot of papers, but it's not really having real world impact, we launched this project called Wild Seve. And Seve in Kannada means in service of. So we launched this around in Karnataka, around Bandipur and Nagarhole, because they had the highest number of conflict incidents. What it is a very simple 1-800 toll-free number that any person can call into, and our field team will go there, assess the incident damage, and help them file the claim with the government. Our role here as an NGO is to not to disperse claims, but to try and see if the government gets more efficient and transparent in their payouts of compensation. And now, of course, we've used Open Data Kit. All of this is done on a mobile phone. Ultimately, it gets printed in a government form in triplicate and submitted. But at least the response monitoring part of it is all very, it's basic tech, but it's important tech, right? So what have we accomplished? Over the last 3 years, we've serviced 600 villages. We've filed 10,500 claims, and 6,000 families have received 1.6 crores back from the government in compensation thanks to our efforts. We've been able to identify, actually the biggest problem and challenge is actually elephants. Tigers and leopards cause far less damage. And in the end, what it does is you have a team of 10 people servicing 600 villages, but the fact that we show up there 98% of the time within 24 hours makes people realize that we don't just care for wildlife, we also care for people and care to help them when they are in trouble and have lost something. So what it's done is also we have live data coming in every day, so we know where there are repeat incidents taking place. In this case, these are all incidents where livestock have been killed by tigers and leopards repeatedly for a particular family. We've gone in and built livestock sheds, which is a very effective solution to prevent repeat attacks. After doing Wild Survey for the last 3 years, we realized we actually weren't having we weren't reaching the children. There are all of these children living in high conflict villages who have no positive views about wildlife or love for any of the animals that we are interested in. So about 2 months ago, we launched a program called Wild Chalet, and it's basically it's a conservation education program that reaches schools who live on the edges of all of these parks. If you look at most children's books, you find that they're designed with animals not found in India. So I'm working with an art student from Srishti, and we're using Indian animals to kind of get them to care for Indian wildlife. We have trained educators, all of whom have master's degrees from different institutions. The purpose of this program is threefold. It is to build empathy for wildlife. So just a quick story, we showed them a short video of elephants swimming. We had a class of 100 children stand up and start clapping because they didn't know elephants could swim. Simple stuff like that. How do you get people to love an animal without knowing anything about the animal, right? We make them play an elephant game where they go all pretend to be elephants and forage for food. It's also a math game. They have to count up how much food. And in the end, if you've not collected 250 kilograms of food, you're not going to survive because elephants need 250 kilograms per day to survive. We also try and build some ecological knowledge, but not in a boring textbook way. We make it fun. This is a food web exercise where all the kids are, pretending to be different animals in a system, and what happens when you lose an insect versus a grass versus an elephant, and as the system collapses, it's something that people start to feel when you're playing that kind of game, right? And in the end, we also use art and role-playing because I think standard boring ways of teaching science education are not going to build empathy or awareness any longer. And finally, the purpose, of course, is to cope with conflict. These are children who have not directly, may not have been directly affected by a tiger or an elephant or a leopard, but they've seen it in their village, they've seen it in their neighborhoods, and basic safety of what you do when wild animals come into your village or into your house. And of course, being scientists, we do pre and post evaluations, tracking every child, seeing whether we've actually succeeded or failed. And this is really important because a lot of conservation organizations just take money, implement projects, never evaluate whether we've done a good job or not, and where we've not done a good job and how we change things. And this kind of evaluation is very, very essential. So the goal of this program, this year alone, we expect to reach about 2,000 children in Karnataka. Next year the plan is 10 to 15,000 children in other parts of India, and eventually lakhs of children, because the district education officers are very interested in us implementing this program. So I think as I go forward, at the end of the day, I've spent 20 years of my life being a scientist. Science lays the bedrock of how we implement these projects. We need to know what the problem is before we start interventions like Wild Chalet and Wild Save. And I hope as we go along, we're able to build more meaningful interventions that have an impact. And I kind of want to close with this, this point that we lost a lot of wildlife, we recovered that wildlife, and the question is, over the next 20, 30 years, basically your lifetime, my lifetime, are we going to, you know, start the downslide again, or are we going to continue to recover our wildlife and still meet the needs of a country of, you know, that's going to be 1.5 billion people pretty soon? So we take a lot of volunteers. If you guys want to come and volunteer with us in our field projects, either for research or conservation, always welcome. Please get in touch with me, and I hope we continue to rewild India, because I'm an optimist. 9 times out of 10, we lose in my profession, but the one time that we do win, it's a big win. And for me, projects like Wild Save and hopefully Wild Chalet, really, I've seen the impact it's had, and I'm hoping we can kind of collaborate and build more solutions like this. So thank you very much for having me today.